Ladies and gentlemen, things are going to heat up now because we have now a panel discussion on a relook at Naxalism in Bengal. 50 years, almost, why? 50 years back, in 1968, I believe a Swedish gentleman had come to Kolkata. And Kolkata was in the throes of the Naxal movement. And he had sort of crystallized his experience in a very, very telling statement. He said that, well, this is the first time ever in the history of the world something very strange is happening. The middle class is boiling over in revolution for the empowerment of the landless poor in the rural areas. Something which has not happened before, something which has not happened since. The Naxal movement is very, very, let's say, special to the Bengali psyche. The relationship is complicated. 50 years hence, there have been a lot of dynamics going on. But I would like to quote a line from a very well-known filmmaker, Onik Dotto, who's going to be part of our film panel later. In one of his recent films, he had said, he had coined this word, noxalgia. The eternal abiding nostalgia that the people of Kolkata, the people of Bengal have for the Naxal movement. Right. So we're going to go back and forth. We have someone who is not only going to talk about it, he's been it. He has been very much a part of the movement and gone through all the ordeals that this particular movement had imposed. And he is none other than Ajizul Haq. We have Vivek Agnihotri, who in his cult film, Buddha in a Traffic Jam, has identified a particular group called the Urban Naxalite. And he talks about very, very complex nexuses that exist between them and other major forces. We have at the other end of the spectrum, Major Gaurav Arya. Major Arya is an Indian journalist specializing in defense and strategic affairs. And he hosts this very popular program called The Patriot. He also writes on defense and shares his experiences with the brave soldiers who keep our frontiers safe. So can we request all the members of the panelists to come up onto the dais, and we would request the founder of Arth A Culture Quest, Shreysi Goenka, to come up and felicitate our panelists. The moderator, yes. Dr. Khasnabis, Rotun Khasnabis, is the moderator. He teaches quantitative techniques, advanced optimization techniques. My God, this is really. And research methodology for MBA and PhD students. And indeed, something which we can all identify with, he has won the Eminent Teacher Award of Calcutta University. Amader shomosto panelistra chole eshechen. এবং আজকে আমরা পেছন ফিরে থাকাবো আমাদের সেই নস্টালজিয়া অ্যান্ড দ্য নক্সাল মুভমেন্ট। তো সমস্ত প্যানেলিস্টরা এখানে উপস্থিত হয়েছেন এবং এদেরকে আমরা এখন আর্থের উত্তরীয় দিয়ে স্বাগত জানাব। ক্যান আই রিকোয়েস্ট মিসেস শ্রেয়সী গোয়েঙ্কা টু ডু দি অনার্স। The moderator, Ajizul Haq, Vivek Agnihotri, and Major Gaurav Arya.
Should we start or? Oh, very good afternoon to everybody present here. Should it be in English or the local language? I think it should be in English because you will feel comfortable in English. And therefore, the proceedings will be in English, or it could be bilingual. If someone thinks, even from the audience, that he should raise a question, or only in English, okay, I'm sorry. If someone from the audience, while interacting, I was just trying to hovering with the idea that from the floor, questions could come from in Bengali also. But as the organizers tell me that proceedings here, everything will be in English. And therefore, when we would interact with the audience, I would rather tell you to speak in English so that we have no language barrier or language problem in conducting this particular interactive session. This will be an interactive session, I tell you. And I am the moderator of this panel. A brief introduction of myself had been there. I am basically a teacher, and therefore, like a teacher, I am speaking, as you find now. But anyway, before entering into the subject, I need not speak much as a moderator at the beginning of the session. But a particular point had been there very much in my mind. While I was reading Amartya Sen's Argumentative India, I liked the book very much because it was a product of knowledge, no doubt about this thing. But at the same time, one question had been there in my mind, that was that there are cases, there are situations where the reason does not prevail. And if the reason does not prevail, even reason based on rationality, if the reason does not prevail, what argument can actually fetch? This is the question which comes in my mind whenever I confront or face a situation where I find that the reason is not working. People are not behaving on the basis of a rational choice. And the rational choice, if there is no space for a rational choice in the society, then definitely the question of violence will come. If in a society there is much disparity and no answer to this thing by any government, from one generation to another generation, this disparity is actually escalating or mounting like anything, then how an argumentative Indian can actually confront such a situation with bullet or with ballot? Actually, this is the area where the debate should be. With this elementary words, introductory words, I would start this particular seminar or session. Where does reason prevail? And if the reason does not prevail, what could be the answer? This should be the pivotal point for discussion while we discuss the issue of Naxalism, who do not speak in terms of what we call the reason, quote unquote. And this problem is very much there in India. And on this thing, we have three very good speakers, the panelists here. The first panelist, should I start from the left? Yes, I should start with one exponent of Naxalite ideology. So Azizul Haq. Azizul Haq has a background that he was initiator of the movement of Naxalbari movement, which started from Bengal. He was one of the initiators. We all know him as Azizul Da. So Azizul Da will speak first. Then possibly Vivek Agnihotri. You are and then Major Sabha. Okay. So this order I will maintain. Each speaker will speak for 10 minutes. First 5 minutes will present his case. And the next 5 minutes, there would be argument, if any, on the topic. We are all argumentative Indians. So 5 minutes for you to have your point here. You speak, and after that the issue will be open to the floor. You shall have to discuss this issue. You shall have to discuss this issue with the people in the audience. They will argue. Okay, Ayodhya, please. He will speak standing as usual. I have never seen Ayodhya speaking by sitting at a place comfortably. He would rise up, stand up, and speak in the spirit of a 17, 18 year boy. This is Ayodhya. So, speak. Achha, where is the timer?
The truth that the workers sweat will never utter. The truth that his empty stomach will never utter. The truth that his tears will never utter. The truth that his toiling feet will not utter. Yes, Barbara Rao, my friend. The truth blackening the white paper, a poet cannot express this agony of a worker, this agony of a empty belly, this agony of a toiling mass. So, for his love, for this toiling mass, Barbara is languishing in jail, and one of my closest friends. And he was termed as Naxalite, urban Naxalite. But what is that? What is that? Days of British Raj. Etlike jokhon jiggesh kora hocche apni ei rokom bhabe desh take bhag kore diye chole gelen keno? Bollo na hole ami amader sompotti rakhte pattam na. Ei je মানে ট্রান্সফার অফ পাওয়ার হলো এ গ্রেট বিট্রায়াল ইন 1947 ট্রান্সফার অফ পাওয়ার মানে টু কোট ঋত্বিক ঘটক এ গ্রেট বিট্রায়াল হোয়াট হ্যাপেন ইন 1947 এবং তারপরে গোটা ভারতবর্ষ জুড়ে যে ইতিহাসটা তৈরি হচ্ছিল যে ইতিহাসটা ভারতের ইতিহাস নয় সেইগুলোকে যখন ইতিহাস বলে চালানো হচ্ছিল সেই জিনিসগুলোই নকশালবাড়ি আবার নকশালবাড়ির কৃষকরা সেই জিনিসগুলোই আমাদের সামনে নিয়ে এসে হাজির করেছিল যে এদেশে যা কিছু মহান সৃষ্টি সে তাজমহলই হোক আর অজন্তা ইলোরাই হোক সে সবের পেছনেই আছে আমাদের কৃষক এবং আমাদের আর্টিজান ক্লাসের অবদান কবি যতই বলুন না কেন বাহিরে তার শাহজাহান অন্তরে তার মমতাজ নারী বাহিরে শাহজাহান কিন্তু আমরা তো জানি ইতিহাস সেই হাজার হাজার আর্টিজান ক্লাস অনেক ঐতিহাসিকই বলে থাকেন যার ফলশ্রুতি হতে 76-এর মন্বন্তর তাজমহলের ফলশ্রুতি 76-এর মন্বন্তর বলে অনেকেই বলে থাকেন তাদের কথা একবার তো আমরা মনে করি না যে রেশনালিটির কথা আসছে তাহলে সেই রেশনালিটি সেই ইতিহাসগুলোকে মানুষকে মনে করিয়ে দেবার জন্যেই কৃষকরাই আবার তুলে নিয়েছিলেন হাতে অস্ত্র সে অস্ত্রটা হচ্ছে অত্যন্ত সঙ্গতভাবে যে অনেকদিন তোমাদের কর্তৃত্ব মেনেছি তোমাদের অনেক শাসক দেখেছি এবারে আমরা যারা সৃষ্টি করি যা কিছু ভারতবর্ষের মহান সব কিছুই আমাদের রক্ত ঘামে তৈরি যেটা ব্রেক্ট বলেছেন রোম গড়ে তুলেছিল কারা সেই যে যাদের তারাই ঘোষণা করেছিলেন ওইখানকার কৃষকরাই যে এবার থেকে আমাদের ভাগ্য আমরাই গড়ব ইজ ইট রং এবং সেটা গোটা ভারতবর্ষ ছড়িয়ে গেছিল অন্ধ্রেও অন্ধ্র জন্ম দিয়েছিলেন একেবারে নকশালবাড়ি ঠিক মানে আরও উন্নত স্তরের শ্রীকাকুলামের এবং এই শ্রীকাকুলামের জন্মের মধ্যে দিয়েই আমরা পেয়েছিলাম পানিগ্রাহী মতো কবিকে, এবং তাদেরই উত্তরসূরী হিসাবে বেরিয়ে এসেছিলেন শ্রী বারবারা রাও বা ইত্যাদি। Barbara is languishing in jail. Barbara, you are spending your days and with all your heart aching, and my heart is bleeding for you. That is for this reason I am dedicating this day to Barbara Rao, my friend.
Thank you, Ajulda. Actually, if I could summarize, it is very difficult to summarize the emotions which had been there in the speech of Ajulda. Emotions apart, there are two points. First point was that in 47 we had a republic. That republic was not working. Was not working in favor of the ordinary toiling people. From it, the second point comes. The second point was that if the republic does not work by itself, then it was inevitable that there would be upsurge of the people who built this country, that is the peasants, workers. And that upsurge in 1967-68 period actually took up a form of a new kind of people's upsurge, which culminated in some peasant struggle in Andhra, and Ajulda on his behalf welcomes this kind of movement that was only necessary in order to build up a second republic, a new republic, not the republic that we find in our arena. So this is how I could summarize without the emotions which had been there in him. If a republic was built up, that has to be replaced with a new republic. This is his point. The issue is now open for discussion in the floor. If someone would ask any question or anything. No? Is it? Only 5 minutes? That could be. That is more reasonable, I think. Let everyone speak for 5 minutes, and after that we will face the encounter, okay? You shall have to face the music. So the next one, may I request Mr. Bibek Ognetri to speak 5 minutes.
You can go there, or if you want to sit here.
I can definitely stand. Thank you very much. Thank you, Z. Thank you, Shashi. Thank you, Vikram. I think we are addressing one of the most important issues of our times. Ajulda, I do not agree with you at all. Absolutely do not agree. You do not have to demolish a republic to create a new republic. This whole talk of revolution, I think, is very bogus. All these revolutions all over the world, historically speaking, have always failed, including the Great October Revolution. The only revolution in the history of humanity which has succeeded was a peaceful revolution called Indian freedom struggle. No revolution besides that has ever succeeded. Everything else is intellectual. This Naxalism, do you realize it started in 67, 68, and up to early 70s? India lost a war to China, but still we survived. In 67, a proxy war started in Naxal Bari, which ultimately was called Naxalism. This was a proxy war started by China, which is still continuing. And the reason being, you have to understand, in this world, all the civilizations perished, including Egyptian, Aztec, Roman, all the civilizations. Only two survived, Hindu civilization and Chinese civilization, and their neighbors. Hindu civilization is the only open, liberal, democratic, progressive, and scientific civilization. Whereas Chinese civilization is a closed civilization. It doesn't make any sense for China, which has always been an expansionist power, to have a democracy as big as India, which is the second largest in terms of population also. They somehow wanted to break us. When they couldn't do it through war because of the international diplomatic reasons, they started in Naxalbari. And slowly, and the reason I say it, Dada, when these young boys looted a police station, took their arms, and started killing landlords, the first incident happened early in the morning. The news came few hours before the incident in Chinese main newspaper. After this Naxal movement, the first one I'm talking about, on the streets of China, there were young boys who were saying that they believe in Chinese premier than Indian. Now this reference to Chinese has been right from the beginning. How is it possible that some young students pick up guns and the Chinese newspapers report it, Indian newspapers don't, and that too before the incident took place? Which means it was trained, funded, inspired by Mao's philosophy. And Mao definitely cannot be a friend of India. And why this movement is absolutely a failed movement? Besides, if there was no Chinese money involved in this, if there was no red terror money involved in it, it wouldn't have survived. The reason is at the same time, exactly the same time in late 60s, in the western part of India, a different movement started, which was for the same objective. Here the objective was to take the land from the landless labor peasant and from the zamindar and give it back to the landless peasant. And in the western India, the same movement started with the same objective to take the land back from the zamindar and give it back to the peasant. It was started by Vinoba Bhave. It was called Bhudan movement. Vinoba Bhave alone, without any clothes on his body, walked lakhs and lakhs of miles, and the total hectares of land he actually got back and gave it back to peasants is all recorded, land by land, hectare by hectare. We do not know how much land these Naxals have got back to the landless peasant. No record, we have no clue, no idea. They have been saying that they are running this movement for last 50 years in the red corridor, which is Jharkhand, Bastar, Andhra Pradesh. Now it has spread in lots of places. They have been arguing that they have been running basically for the downtrodden, the Adivasi. I have extensively in last 10 years traveled, met thousands of people. I travel 20 days in a month, and one question I keep asking, find me one Adivasi, bring him here and tell me, if he tells me that yes, his life has improved because of Naxal movement, we can understand. Today, it has become a big extortion racket. It's become a movement of freeloaders. To the tune of, and this is an official figure, to the tune of 1100 crore to 1500 crore rupee is extorted every year from poor Adivasi, this little girl.
Vivek, 5 minutes.
Okay, one more minute, let me speak. So, this little girl who goes to sell tendua leaves, even she's extorted. If she earns 500 rupees, 100 rupees are taken from her. And this 1100 to 1500 crore rupees from Bastar alone and another 300 to 500 crore rupees from Jharkhand, where does this money go? Nobody asks. Even the propagators, the advocates of Naxalism, they don't ask. This money goes to urban areas. It goes to urban areas to create a constant conflict, chaos, anarchy, and a state of civil war. That is what is urban Naxalism. Today, Naxalism in villages is only to extort money and send it to urban areas. If you remember recently, documents which were found from Professor Sai Baba, the 5 strategic documents, they have a urban perspective document which states it's in its objective to take over the state of India by 2025 with armed revolution. And the strategy is, how will you take it? You take it by capturing cities. How will you capture cities? By opening front organizations. And these front organizations are legal cells, academic cells, the intellectual cells, and human rights cells, all kinds of NGOs. There's a big nexus which has been created. They're an urban Naxalism because they don't want our country to grow and develop.
Okay, thank you. Should I summarize this thing? If I am to summarize this thing, I would summarize in this way. It had three statements. One is China engineered the early Naxalbari movement. This is statement number one. Statement number two, there had been something called Bhudan movement, which actually succeeded. Third point is that Naxal movement, which was revamped after, say, 20, 25 years of the first phase of the movement, that is simply extorting money from the rural areas, rural Adivasis, send it to the urban areas, and on the basis of that monetary, monetary support or financial support, something develops in the urban areas which is called urban Naxal. This is the summary of what I could gather from Vivek Agnihotri. May I now request Mr. Gaurav Acharya to speak?
So shall I start?
Yes, please.
I have a very, very strong objection to this entire glamorization of armed conflict. And the reason why Naxalism has failed and will continue to fail is for one simple reason. The farmers and the Naxal leadership have different goals. What the farmer wants is justice. What the farmer wants, or may want in some areas of India, is essentially redistribution of land. What he may want is a correct price for his crop. The farmer of India certainly does not want to use the gun to come to power. Mao said power flows through the barrel of the gun, and that is the driving ideology of the Naxals. Now, the Naxals have used the farmers traditionally, the tribals traditionally, to be their fighting force. But there is divergence, and that divergence can be seen in areas I have traveled widely in Chhattisgarh, and I will very briefly tell you two, three things. How do you treat malaria in the jungles of Chhattisgarh? The poor tribals are not allowed to have allopathic medicines. The Naxals will kill, they will beat to death people who take medicines. So the tribals take a person afflicted with brain malaria, tie him to a tree at night, and this tree will have red ants. And when the red ants come down and tear his skin apart, the tribal screams. And then they say that the malaria is going out of his body. This is one of the gifts of Naxalism. There are last two things which I'd like to mention. I'm sorry, the time is very short. Why can't I have a grouse? Just because I'm middle class? Do I have to be a farmer? Do I have to be a worker to have a grouse? Do I have to be a farmer to be oppressed? And do I have to be a farmer or a peasant to pick up a gun? Tomorrow, if I have a problem, is it okay for me to go and pick up an AK-47 and say that I want my kind of state? If tomorrow you have a problem with stopping at the traffic signal, should you get violent? When democracy started off, it had very bad examples to go by. Adolf Hitler was a result of democracy. Winston Churchill was a result of democracy. But our founding fathers, the founding fathers of India, they took a leap of faith and they adopted democracy as a way of life, as a way of governance. Today, if you say that Naxalism came into being simply because after 20 years, we achieved independence in 47, by 67 people were dissatisfied, saying that we need an alternate form of government. We were dissatisfied with that form of government. What does that mean? Naxalism has been going on for more than 50 years. If democracy, if they could declare democracy a failure in 20 years, what about Naxalism? It's been going on for 50 years and it has been failing consistently. This, my basic problem, is against the romanticization of picking up arms. It is very cheap. There are some people who die, and there are other people who sit in universities and give gyan to all of you people like you and me, saying that do this, do that. There are very little people who pick up the gun. And those who do, let me tell you, and I say this as a formal soldier, if you pick up arms against the state, you will be met by armed response. All right? There is a way in which we have agreed as citizens of this country, we will run this country. Now, no society is perfect. America has campus shootings every second week. Hundreds of people die every year because people pick up the gun and shoot. So is America perfect? It's not. Is Russia perfect? No. China, the birthplace of Mao, is more capitalist than America. Even our country is not perfect. Maybe we'll take 200 years to get perfect. But today, let us understand that we have to persevere with a certain form of governance. If you start supporting armed struggle, then who am I to say that the gentleman sitting there, his cause is not right? Everybody's cause is right. Your cause is right. My cause is right. So let's all pick up guns. Let's all start killing each other. And then what kind of a country would we have? So we have to show faith. Democracy in India is still work in progress. And after I see Donald Trump, I feel even in America, it's work in progress. It'll take time. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much, Major Gaurav Arya. And actually, I'm sorry that I misspelled your name. As it is not Chaudhary, it would be Arya. He was very brief and very pointed kind of thing. And I liked it. Should I summarize this thing? I don't think I need to summarize this one, because he did make a summarized way of putting his points. If there is anything from the floor or from others here, that will come. So the issue will now be open for discussion. Any question or intervention from the, not really intervention, something for the, from the floor. I have 11 minutes left. So I would want to spend this time, that is 11 minutes, for an open session kind of discussion, where of course you will also be speaking, but let me see if there is an audience from the, any reaction from the audience. Hello. So anything from the audience?
Hello. Thank you for the lucid discussion. We heard from both sides of the debate. One quick question as a general citizen of India is, I don't want to take sides, but in both sides, if you are fighting, if the armed forces are fighting with the tribals of India, so I think as a general citizen, whoever dies in the mine blast or everything, it's Indians dying. So isn't it stupid to kill each other just so that we have a lesser number of people who will rule others? Is it stupid not to start a civil war? Thank you.
Can I answer this?
Yes, of course you can. And I will expect reaction from you also.
Yes.
Yes.
Sir, two things. You said that you don't want to take sides. I would beg to differ. I think you should take sides. It's a question of your country. Right, sir? So, pardon my being flippant, but this is not Big Boss. This is India. So we live and we die for this country. India's son from Bengal, Subhash Chandra Bose, gave his life for this country. He never said, I will not take sides. That's number one. Number two, the armed forces are not killing tribals, sir. The armed forces are not involved in anti-Naxal operations or anti-Maoist operations. That is Home Ministry. This is a technical point I'm trying to make. And number three, sir, anybody, any Indian who picks up arms against the state is a traitor. You cannot pick up arms against the state. There are conditions, there are articles in the Constitution, there are methods in the Constitution which give you, you know, legal redress, which give you the right to choose your own government. As I said, it's work in progress. It's not a perfect system. But this entire thing about a person picking up weapons against the state and saying that I protest, I'm sorry, sir, it doesn't work that way. Any person who picks up the... You asked me a question in Bangla, it becomes my moral responsibility to answer in Bangla or tell you, sir, I don't understand Bangla. Similarly with Hindi or English or Punjabi. So, sir, if your question is with the gun, the answer will be with the gun, sir.
Sir, Okay. Just a quick question. I want some answer to this question from Mr. Ajijul Haq.
Any response from Ajulda, the way he wanted to confront the issue?
Okay. Last page of this constitution is to be burnt. Reference Arun Chowdhury. So the constitution has many provisions, but who is to implement it? How the voting is going on in our country? What happened in Bengal? What happened in Tripura? Are they not getting vote at the barrel of the gun? I was there. I am here. I have seen election of corporation elections and all these things. Even BJP had to try the method. Where should I apply my right? If there is no provision, if there is no security? To quote Romarola again, when reasons fail, you must also consider the armed revolution is also a method, a democratic movement. It is also a democratic right. I will quote Gogol. When Japal Satre, he was impeached in the French Parliament. French Parliament, tara bollo je Japal Satre ke immediately America tini boktita tour korchilen je Japal Satre ke immediately arrest kora hok. Tokhon Dogaler bikkhato boktita je ami 20th century Socrates ke greftar kore jele pure আমি কোনো দিন ইতিহাসের কাছে ক্ষমা পাব না.
আইল আই হ্যাভ 5 মিনিটস লেফট. আই হ্যাভ অনলি 5 মিনিটস লেফট.
ও আচ্ছা সরি.
ওকে
দেন আই অ্যাম
সো আই আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ড ইফ মিস্টার অগ্নিহোত্রী হ্যাজ এনিথিং টু স্পিক অন দিস পার্টিকুলার থিম
অর ইফ দেয়ারস এনি নিউ কোশ্চেন আই ক্যান আনসার দ্যাট
অর হ্যালো
ইফ ইউ ক্যান স্পেসিফিকলি আস্ক
কত 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 এই যে স্যার আই ওয়ান্ট
টু আস্ক আ কোশ্চেন টু
বোথ অফ ইউ আস্ক দা কোশ্চেন আই উইল সামারাইজ ইট
ওকে
অলসো হোয়াট ইজ দ্যাট you won't speak on this one.
Yeah, let both of them ask a question. I'll summarize.
Sure, sure. This is my prerogative. I just want to know whether you want to have any reaction on the issue raised by
I think already it's been said from
okay,
both
fine.
The sides.
Okay, fine. No problem.
I'll address new question.
So, let me go for a new one.
Sir, my name is Niladri Banerjee. I have a question regarding the comment the previous speaker made. He spoke about Subhash Chandra Bose. Now, Subhash Chandra Bose himself took up arms and led an armed revolution against the then Indian government ruled by the British. Secondly, Subhash Chandra Bose said there are three phases to freedom: political freedom, economic freedom, and social freedom. Unfortunately, even after more than 70 years of independence, most people in India don't have economic freedom. So my question is, if Subhash Chandra Bose and other revolutionaries could take up arms for political freedom, why can't people in India take up arms to get economic freedom against the corrupt government and officials across India? Thank you.
Sir, the same question goes for me.
Let him ask. Also ask.
The question is there. Anything?
We have heard that Mao Zedong has always said that if there would be any sort of counter-revolution also, then you need to hit back them by another counter-revolution. So over here, the movement which has been made for only protecting the rights of the farmers and the poor farmers who have been deprived from their lands, and there has been the acquisitions forcefully, then why such revolution will not get the proper status of a national movement?
Okay, so more or less both of you are saying, sir.
I think there are these two questions I will take. Buzz them.
I'll answer. Let me reply. Sir, what you are saying is more of a brainwashing than the real situation. You are talking about economic freedom. You think we don't have economic freedom in this country? If a young IIT, a boy who comes from a college, if he's enterprising, he wants to start a business, you mean to say he cannot? Then how come we have millions of thriving businesses in this country? You make choices. When you go to a mall, you decide which brand you want to buy. That's economic freedom. By economic freedom, if you mean that somebody, government should come and give you money, that is economic freedom, then I'm sorry, you are living in a wrong country. You should be in China or Russia. This is a romanticization, absolutely, like he said. India does not need these kind of revolutions. India needs revolution of efficiency. India needs revolution of productivity. India needs that kind of a revolution if we want to become something. And the problem is, these people, the Naxals and the communists and the entire leftist ideology, is anti-success. They don't want success. And that is the reason most of the country is always gripped with this problem of social anarchy, economic anarchy. They want, why labor in this 2018 needs to form trade unions and go for a protest? We live in one of the most free countries.
Because of protecting their rights.
Let me reply. You ask the, I'll come to you.
No, you are not replying the question. The question had been.
Question is about economic freedom. Question, he's saying, why don't we have economic freedom?
That had been
no, not
against
only economic freedom. I just want this status.
Sir, I'm
like
replying to the first
to
gentleman, not
a national movement.
No. What is your question? Please ask me loudly.
I just want to ask.
That, the question was not against you. That had been on Mr. Arya's point that no one should take up arms against the state. But a gentleman from the floor actually asked the wisdom of this particular statement.
Such movement.
I'm very confused. One second. I'm very confused.
I just said that this sort of movement, which are always there for fighting against the right of poor farmers or beneath the poor level, so why do we need that this movement should get the status of national movement?
Sir, to clarify my question again, I asked, someone quoted about Subhash Chandra Bose.
Oh, so I thought you were asking me about economic freedom.
No.
So he has to answer that.
Either Subhash Chandra Bose was wrong in fighting for freedom.
I have understood your question, sir. Subhash Chandra Bose was not wrong, but he was fighting the British. You're talking about people fighting Indians. Now, there is a difference between Subhash Chandra Bose fighting for the freedom of this nation, whether political, whether economic, whether social, that is one part. Secondly, you cannot equate. See, as I said, democracy in India has many flaws, but democracy in America also has many flaws. It has flaws. It is work in progress. All I'm saying is there are, you know, ways and means within the Constitution of India to correct. There are amendments in the Constitution by which you can correct and go the right way. I'm not saying that the current dispensation is absolutely right. No, it might take 100 years or 200 years for it to settle. But picking up arms, you cannot see. Subhash Chandra Bose was a hero. He rose up against the British. To compare Naxals to Subhash Chandra Bose is like the same person who spoke on a television debate. I do not want to name the channel today. He spoke on a debate. Seeing that, I entered media. I left my job in a corporate. That person said that the terrorist Burhan Wani was like Shahid Bhagat Singh. You cannot make these comparisons. Subhash Chandra Bose is here. Naxals are here.
And just to Subhash Chandra Bose wasn't killing his own people. Do you know what happens in Bastar? I'll tell you something which I have seen. A four-month-old child was taken from his parents, from the mother, and his skull was broken with a hammer. Then his intestines were taken out and burnt in a bonfire. Who are you comparing Subhash Chandra Bose with? Just see, barbarians and a genuine nationalist.
That is horrible, of course. But anybody from the floor?
I'm there.
Any other
Vikram,
question?
Vikram.
Yes, you have.
Vikram.
My question is to Mr. Ajizul Haqda. We're talking about freedom fighters and equating Subhash Chandra Bose and others, but they had an alternative view of what the new republic should be like. Now, after 50 years, what is the agenda? What is the new constitution? What is the nature of that new republic? You said you need to destroy that republic and establish a new one. Does this new republic have any features? Is there a plan, or is destruction the only plan? Is there a new creation? If so, what is that new creation and what does that stand for? That's never been articulated to anybody.
That's a very good question, I think.
Why? The term Naxalite, first I said, it is a misnomer. The party CPI-ML has a program, strategy, and tactics in its first Congress. You can go through that. What do they mean? And what they said, they meant it. They were trying to do this.
His point is that actually there is a new concept of republic, and that is there in the program of CPI-ML?
That is in the program of CPI-ML.
Mr. Arya has a point.
Sir, very small interjection here. Anything that you do in any country which is a democracy, a self-proclaimed democracy, and we have given to ourselves this constitution, people should accept it. Now the communists have been fighting elections for donkey's years. They have never come to power, except in states. They have never come to power in the center, which
but
essentially means...
Mr. Arya, sir, when a state comes with guns...
Please allow me, sir.
Allow one
me to
minute.
Complete my sentence.
When
sir.
A state comes with gun, what the people will say?
Sir, state has never come...
Who have said you?
I'll tell you,
I
sir.
Myself is a sufferer.
I am sorry, sir. I disagree with you.
I didn't do anything against the state.
Sir...
But why I was put behind bars for as long as 18 to 20
sir,
years?
I'm sorry, sir. I'm not aware of your case. All I can say is that there are hundreds of political parties in India which fight elections.
Anyway, I have seen
what about communists? Nobody's voting.
Allow me to speak as the moderator.
You had been behind
the bars, I know.
What happened there? I was the only reporter from Bengal who reported it from the field.
What?
And as a writer.
What is that? What did you say?
Sir, what
you had been detained for 20 years or so. Okay, without trial or had you been convicted?
No, without trial.
Without trial, he was there behind the bar. And he says this is the state.
Sir, but that cannot be the reason to pick up guns. That's a flaw in the system. But still, we have a judiciary.
When a state take up the gun. So what happened in 1959, 31st August, 80 people died in Calcutta. And they were killed by state machinery.
Sir, that is one side of the story.
What is the other side of the story
we have to figure
thousands
out?
Thousands of peaceful procession was there. And what happened in 1965? Bibhutidab dead. And protesting this, the then Vice Chancellor Triguna Sen, he wrote, on the top of the Jadavpur University black flag. When a state
sir,
take up
Dada,
guns...
Ajil Da, last year in 2016 I came to Jadavpur University. Some hundreds of students attacked me and broke my shoulder. I still cannot lift my hand from more than this. My physiotherapy is going for last 2 years. 2 days ago in Ahmedabad they broke my car. Should I pick up a gun? Should I pick up a gun?
I
do not agree with
my
this.
Point is
I have been a Naxal myself. Been a Naxal myself. I have burned buses. I have thrown stones at Vidhan Sabha. I have been to jail. And that is why I have realized that violence never solves anything.
I also had been in the movement and I was detained for 2 years, more than 2 years. The basic issue, as I pointed out earlier, is this. If the reason prevails, there is no problem. If the reason based on rationality does not prevail, there is a problem. This space is occupied by violence. And this is the social history of mankind everywhere. If reason prevails, no problem. The gap is met by what is called violence. This is the answer to every question which comes.
Sir, how will reason prevail if you start brainwashing young boys and girls of this country? Like in Madarsa, these young boys and girls are brainwashed to become suicide bombers. If all our professors are going to teach that it is right to pick up the gun, if only thing they are going to teach is negativity, they are always going to focus on what is not there instead of what we have. Just do you realize that in 70 years what we have achieved, no other society in the history of humanity has ever achieved.
I am sorry, sir.
Sir,
this
we are a great country. We have achieved greatness.
What China has achieved, we could not actually touch it.
Sir, except and for freedom, you just can't talk. That's the only problem.
If you think in terms of GDP and every indicator of development, China is far ahead of India.
Sir, if your
this
child is
my,
picked up from your house, you
I
can't
tell
question
you,
the government.
This is my professional area.
Sir,
please do not enter into this area.
Sir, ek professor
sir, you have your point.
Sir.
You have your point. You had adequate time to speak on your point. And everybody understood what is there in your argument. Everybody understood what is the powerful point of Gaurav Acharya. Everybody understood nobody here is a fool. understood what Ayurveda wanted to speak. And I think I should wrap up the discussion in this way. It is already some 10 minutes I had and this is over. Anything? Anything? Some people are raising hands, but I don't know. We don't have enough time. You want to speak?
What would you say is the economic impact of Naxalism in Bengal? This is for everyone.
Naxalite?
The Naxalism movement in Bengal, what has the economic impact been on the state?
What had been the economic impact on the state?
Yes.
Actually, left could not come to power and the left ideology could not dominate for such a long time in Bengal unless there had been some rebellion in the presidency college. In other top-ranked institutes of West Bengal, from which a different kind of reasoning could come. And that different kind of reasoning was based on Marxism and actually changed Bengal in such a way that people in the next generation could understand what the state could give. Actually, there had been reforms in West Bengal. There had been Operations Borga in West Bengal. There had been the sense of entitlement through panchayats. This came in West Bengal. The Chotoloks of West Bengal could understand how are they differentiated and what is the difference between Bhadrolok and Chotolok. And this is the thing which Bengal achieved. I am proud of that Bengal. I tell you.
Anything else?
Ar kichu bolben Bhadrolok Chotoloker moddhe tofatta tule diyechilo bam front. Ar tar pechone chilo apnar ei kichu bhalo cheleme. Presidency college chhele me jara rasta neme porechilo, and that was it changed the Bengali mind. Ajkal oi bhabe ar kotha bola jay na, eta rickshaw lage tui bola jay na. That is the achievement of a movement jekhane onek gulo chhele bachcha chhele pran diye gechilo tader opore tader blood er opore dari ekta new society has emerged where people have been empowered with what is called their own one sense of respect, self-respect. Okay. I should end there because this discussion would be unending. Abar. Acha, bolun. Shunun, ekta class e amra 50 minute cha chai. Tar pore 5-7 minute cholte pare. Tar pore amra boli je amader ghore ashun eshe kotha bolun. If you have some other questions that could go for private discussion, I will take only one question or one point. From the floor, the gentleman there, yeah.
Mera naam Gautam Agarwal hai. Mera prashn Mr. Arya se, Gaurav Arya se hai. Hum sabhi log naksal ki baate karte hai ki naksalwad ek bahut badi samasya hai. 50 saal se hum naksalwad ki samasya ko jhel rahe hai. Lekin koi bhi iska samadhan nahi batata hai ki ye isko kaise khatam kiya ja sakta hai. तो मैं मिस्टर आर्या से जानना चाहता हूं कि इस समस्या का हल क्या है
मिस्टर आर्या
इस समस्या का हल आई थिंक 3 फेजेस में है जो नक्सल अफेक्टेड एरियाज हैं वहां पे मैसिव इकोनॉमिक डेवलपमेंट जो कि नक्सल्स खुद अपोज करते हैं पिछले 5 साल में छत्तीसगढ़ और आसपास के इलाकों में 155 सीआरपीएफ सोल्जर्स वर मार्टर्ड जस्ट डिफेंडिंग रोड्स मैंने इसके ऊपर एक डॉक्यूमेंट्री बनाई थी ब्लड रोड्स यानी कि आईडी लगा के मार दिया क्योंकि सीआरपीएफ वाले चाहते थे वहां पे सड़क बनाए नक्सल्स नहीं चाहते कहीं पे नक्सल्स डोंट वांट प्रोग्रेस तो जब तक इंसान जाहिल रहेगा जब तक बेचारा गरीब रहेगा तब तक इनके साथ रहेगा अगर थोड़ा पढ़ लिख जाएगा फिर वो क्वेश्चन करेगा तो एक तो चाहते नहीं मैं छत्तीसगढ़ की बात कर रहा हूं आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट छत्तीसगढ़ Number one is massive development. Number two, people must have access to justice. Access to justice. The courts, the local system must function. I understand that Naxalism started because the local system did not function. But the response was not correct. Right? The system must function. And number three.
If the system functions
number three,
for the people.
Sir, allow me to complete, sir. Number three.
Please, I cannot continue, sir.
Sir. He's asked me a question. I have the right to complete at least answer.
Please,
if it has 3 points, then it has 3 points.
Okay,
sir.
Okay.
And last point is solid armed response. Anybody who picks up the state, picks up a gun against the state, will have to be dealt with violence. Leave the door open for them to come back into the mainstream. But if people persist, then they are getting what they asked for.
I think you should end that.
Okay.
Actually, this could go for unending discussion, violence, reason, and the end of reason. And so many things will come for discussion. And this also belongs to the philosophical arena. In philosophy, in books of philosophy, you will find pages after pages written on this issue. This is not a very simple thing. But anyway, we had a very enlightened discussion from the spoker. Vibrant response from the floor. This I wanted to mean. But I wanted to point out that that had also a very good discussion from the participants. I mean the panelists. I had a very good panel, and this panel, people mammals of this panel, actually helped me a lot in conducting this particular kind of seminar, which in my belief is a great success. Thank you all for cooperating with me.